So our next speaker is Andrea Marino, who will talk to us about computing the diameter of weighted link streams. So Andrea, please.
Okay, so hello everybody. It's a pleasure to be there, at least virtually. And okay, this is a joint work with a student of mine, Marco Calamai, ex-student now, and Pierluigi, that is also here. And I will talk about computing diameter weighted link streams. But before going there, I would like to give you a little bit of context. So basically, a lot of time ago, in 2011, the average distance and the diameter of Facebook have been computed. And well, independently on the fact that it's small and it's socially interesting, the value that that came out from this compilation, that what is interesting for us as a computer scientist is that this is quite a huge network. At least at the time, it was 700 million of nodes and 68 billion of edges. And basically, so in this contribution, there were basically two contributions. There was the computation of the average distance that has been done using this algorithm that is the HyperNF tool, which basically estimates the number of pairs of nodes at distance h in time m h m log n. So the first question that we did with Pilou and Clemence was, is it possible to extend this approach to temporal graphs? For instance, in order to estimate the pairs of vertices reachable within time t, in time m log n, where m is the number of temporal edges. And this is what we did in this other paper. So this is about average distance, okay, and reachability. Instead, this talk will be about diameter. Diameter instead is the maximum among all the pairs pairwise distances. And the diameter of Facebook has been computed instead by this our algorithm of our. That was basically computing the diameter of big networks, even though, I mean, we know that, actually we knew it later, at the time we didn't know, that computing the diameter required quadratic time unless the stronger exponential time hypothesis is false. So basically, the other question that came out in last year was, is it possible to extend this approach, okay, this algorithm to compute the diameter of static graphs also to temporal graphs? Okay, and this is what I'm going to talk about now. Okay, first of all, let me introduce a little bit how it works for a static graph. Directed graphs in particular. Why directed? Because it will be more useful for us, the directed case, when we will go to talk about temporal graphs. So here we are assuming that the graph is strongly connected, and like this one, the distance between two nodes is the number of edges along the shortest path, standard. And the eccentricity, the forward eccentricity of a node U is the distance from that node to any other node. While the backward eccentricity of a node is the distance, considering all the shortest path arriving to that node. Okay, so here, for instance, I'm representing all the distances between between each pairs of nodes. So for instance, V1 reach V4 in three steps, it reaches V7 in two steps and so on. So the forward eccentricity in this matrix of distances corresponds to the maximum on the row, and the backward eccentricity corresponds to the maximum on the column. Okay, so how many edges I have to traverse at most in order to reach the target? Okay, V1, for instance, in this case, with five edges, you are able to arrive to V1. So the diameter then is the maximum in this matrix, right? It's the same as saying the maximum forward eccentricity or the maximum backward eccentricity. And of course, I can compute it by applying NBFSs, right? But in if you imagine a graph like Facebook, you have to do 700 million of BFSs. Yeah, I mean, you will never see the end of the algorithm, okay? So we want something that works at the end, is able to compute the diameter of such a huge network in practice, okay? Even we know that there could be very bad graphs that could make it quadratic. And the algorithm that we used basically was using this main observation, that is this. Okay, take a random node, U, any node of the graph, do a backward BFS from it and a forward BFS from it. And now fix a level I, okay? And then I say, if there is a node X above the level I, such that its forward eccentricity is big enough, then there is another node below the level I called Y, whose backward eccentricity is at least the eccentricity of X. Okay, and this is true for any node, for any graph. So basically, symmetrically, you can repeat the reasoning between T and Z. So if you consider LB as the maximum with this variable, the maximum among all the eccentricity that are of nodes that relies below the level I, okay? Basically, what you're saying is that the eccentricity, the backward eccentricities of these guys and the forward eccentricity of these guys above the level I is bounded by the maximum between LB and 2I minus 1, okay? So this is just to give you an idea, the observation, okay? I'm not going to give you the proof. But this gives you already an algorithm, basically, because what you have to do is doing a backward BFS from a node, a forward BFS from the same node, and then starting from the node at farthest distance, you start to do BFSs. And if you are at a generic level I, you have in a variable the maximum eccentricity found so far. And if at some point you arrive and you are also maintaining an upper bound on the nodes that you have still, for which you have still to compute the eccentricity. If you arrive at a certain point in which your lower bound is greater than 2i minus 1, then you can kill the computation because it means that your lower bound, the maximum that you have found so far, it's already the diameter, okay? So, of course, there are degenerate cases. I mean, we are not violating the SDH. Okay, there are degenerate cases for which you can degenerate in the quadratic time, okay? But in practice, it never happens, okay? There are some structural properties or real-world graphs for which basically this it cannot happen. So instead of doing N BFSs, for instance, in the case of Facebook network, he was doing 17 BFSs to compute the diameter. Okay, so now let me go to the diameter of weighted link streams. Okay, so temporal graph, we know what I'm in particular using the same model that Pilou was using. That is basically I have temporal edges that are quadruple, where you have node, time of departure, and lambda is how much time I take to traverse that edge. And the graph, what is crucial here is that the graph is given as a stream of links. Okay, so we are talking about huge graphs, so you cannot store the graph in memory, but you have to scan the edges as a link stream. Now the path we know, okay, I will not repeat the definition that we have seen many times today. But looking at a path now, you can look at different measure, right? The departure time, the arrival time, the duration of this path, that is the arrival minus the departure, the travel time, that is the sum of the traversal time of the edges. And let me say a trivial definition that a path must be t-min, t-max compatible, meaning that the departure time and the arrival time must be inside this window, okay? That is important for next slide. Okay, so given an interval, I can now define several notions of distances, okay? So there is, for instance, the distance earliest arrival time, that is the minimum arrival time minus t min. For instance, in this case, to go to A to G, the arrival time is 10. Okay, the t min is zero, so it is 10. Then I can define the distance latest departure time, that is the t max minus the maximum departure time. So in this case, it corresponds to the path that is leaving latest as latest as possible from A, and this is 4. Okay, so the distance latest it's 19, the t max minus 4, so it's 15. Okay, and this is a little bit weird definition because why? Because we want that all these distances are minimum objective function rather than having one boring distance that is instead a maximization problem. Okay, so then you have fastest time, that is the minimum duration time, and this corresponds to this blue path. You can see that this has just 3 as duration, while the other one have duration larger. Then you have the shortest time, that is instead the minimum travel time, and this corresponds to the green path, okay? So that is the arrival time minus the departure time. We say that a distance is infinite if there is no path. And the eccentricity now I can define analogously. So it's the maximum finite distance from that node to any other node. And the diameter is the maximum among all the eccentricities, right? So it's now that we have defined distances, everything comes as a consequence. And first of all, we can show a negative result, analogous to the one by Roddick and Vasilescu-Williams, to show that actually computing the diameter for any of these 4 distances requires at least quadratic time. I mean, it cannot be done in subquadratic time unless set H is false. And this we did it by doing a quasi-linear reduction from this problem that is the K to disjoint set problem, in which basically you have given a set X and a collection C of subset of X that satisfy this relation. Decide if there are 2 disjoint sets, C, C prime, that are disjoint. And for any K, the KTDS problem is not solvable in time subquadratic with respect to the number of this set, unless set H is 4. And the reduction is quite easy, actually, and this is basically, here we have the universe, x1, x2, x3, and x4, the elements, and c1, c2, c3, they represent the forma clique, the universe forma clique, the set X, and C1, C2, C3 represent the sets, and we are representing the membership giving these times. And we can prove that for any of the distances, AT, FT, and ST, the diameter is 3 if and only if there are 2 disjoint sets. So in this case, for instance, here, the diameter is 3 because C1 and C2, they are disjoint. So again, we have in the same situation. We want to measure something in a huge graph but actually we know that there is the quadratic time barrier that we cannot overcome. But once again, we can maybe do something that is still fast in practice. And what we want to do is mimicking basically the IFUB algorithm that I showed you before in order to be able to compute the diameter of large temporal networks. So another tool that you need in order to do this, if you remember, we were talking about backward and forward BFSs, right? So I need to do a backward and a forward BFS, define it for each of the distances. Okay, and this basically is part of the literature now. And here in this table, we are showing the time required and space required by each of these computations. So you have a single source and single target best path computation. And here you have the several distances. In all these complexities here, we are assuming that the edges is sorted The list of edges, the stream is sorted in non-increasing or not decreasing. So these are done in at pre-processing time. They are there, and we don't pay this cost for each of the visits that we will do. So this is a first building block. A second building block, very important, is connectivity. If you remember well, while I was talking about the study case, I was assuming that the graph was strongly connected or connecting in the case of the undirected graph. But here in temporal graph, this is a problem, right? Because no efficient algorithm is now capable of computing temporal connected component. Actually, we know that this is equivalent to enumerated clicks. And what I would like to do is computing R, that is the pairs of vertices such that they reach each other, U reaches V. But this would cost already quadratic time. So it's also not convenient. So what we did was defining this notion of pivot diameter. Basically, what is a pivot? A pivot is a set of pairs, XT, for instance, that are actually temporal vertices. Okay, so for instance, it could be Gare de Montparnasse at 4 in the afternoon. Now, once I define the set of pivot, I can define R of P as the set of pairs of nodes U and V such that U can reach V passing through a pivot. Okay, so basically, are all the pairs of vertices such that I have the time to go to the pivot, one of the pivot, P, and then go to the destination. Okay, so these, of course, are less than the whole set of pairs. And the P diameter is, instead of being the maximum among all the distances between all the pairs of vertices, will be the maximum for all the pairs that are in this set, RP. Okay, so I am restricting, I'm not considering anymore all the pairs of vertices. I'm restricting myself only to the pairs that have the time to go to the central station and then go to the destination. And okay, the first question is, okay, you are doing this reduction, but how bad can be, right, your set RP with respect to R? Okay, so something that was surprising to us is that if we chose P is in a very, trivial way, that is, choose the top log n nodes having a highest out degree, taking at 4 times, for instance, equally spaced. So if my lifetime is 24 hours, I take Gare de Montparnasse at 4 every 6 hours, basically. So what we are able to show is that RP is almost there. You can see here the ratio between the two. Okay, so basically it means that there is very often a small set of pivot that is able to cover almost all the set of pair. Okay, and also how much does differ this P diameter with respect to the diameter? Here I'm showing for FT and ST, fastest time and shortest time, the ratio between the two. And you can see that very often is close to one. Okay, of course, also the theoretical counterpart is interesting. And then I can tell you that this is just an heuristic. Actually, you cannot prove, what we showed was is that solving the perfect set pivot problem is NP-hard and not approximable within a factor C log N for some constant C greater than zero by a reduction from it in set. Basically, the perfect set pivot set problem is that computing a set of pivot such that RP is equal to R. Okay, okay. So basically, you cannot do this. Okay, there is also an approximation algorithm that whose threshold is greater than C log N. But also it requires too much time, and so is not we cannot use in our setting. Now, okay, we are left with computing the pivot diameter instead of the diameter. And again, if we consider a distance FT, fastest time or shortest time, but it works also for earliest arrival time and latest departure time. The same observation of the static algorithm for static graph, IFUB, applies. So basically, if this is a backward visit, okay, to a pivot UT, and this is a forward visit from the same pivot, okay, this is arriving at set time. This basically is a visit in the interval T min T. This is a visit from T to T max, okay? Basically, what I obtain, to give you an idea, is the same property of IFUB, that is, if there is one guy here above that has a big eccentricity, okay, according to the distance that I have chosen, then there is another guy whose backward eccentricity is bigger than x and is below the level I. Okay, so again, we can repropose the same thing. Now you can see also why, basically, this is crucial, this trick of pivot that we were doing, because what is important here is, in order to give an upper bound on the guys that we have still to process and to prove this property, you need composability between paths. So in order to say that X has a sub upper bound, basically you must be able to compose the path that I see here with the path that I see here. Okay, so this allow me to give upper bound on the eccentricity of the nodes. So, okay, of course, the kind of visit that you do, it depends on the kind of distance that you have chosen, the kind of diameter that you want to compute. So now, if you denote with F the number of visits performed with respect to the number of nodes, okay, so we know that by doing n BFS is, of course, we can compute the diameter and also the part pivot diameter. It's easy, no? But again, we don't want to compute this. So our task was to compute by doing as few BFSs as possible. And here I'm measuring the number of BFSs that I am doing with respect to the number of BFSs that I will do with the textbook algorithm that does n BFS. And here you can see the ratio between the two algorithms. There are some degenerate cases, but the majority of the cases, I mean, we are closer to the zero rather than to one. So once again, the quadratic conditional lower bound, actually, that I show you for the diameter, but I can tell you that the conditional lower bound works also for the pivot diameter. And here we are not breaking, of course, the conditional lower bound, but we are just showing an algorithm that in practice is able to compute the pivot diameter doing very often a few BFSs. I'm not showing the result here for earliest arrival time and latest departure time, because actually what we observe is that we can do even a simpler algorithm by observing that the earliest arrival time diameter often traverses edges with the high time appearance. So basically using this, we can give upper bounds that are more effective. Okay, so that's it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Andrea. Let's thank the speaker. Okay, so who has any questions? Let me check the chat, but I think it's the remainders of the previous discussions. Yes, so any questions? Well, I mean, I can ask a question which kind of eats me now that I have seen your slides. So what's so special about trends? Which was apparently the only special case in one of your tests?
Yeah, well, good question. The point is that there are some bad, basically, gadgets that you can compute in order to make the algorithm fail. And this also depends on the basically on the performance here, okay, the kind of subset of pairs that you selected. And we still don't know which one are the gadgets that could be there to make the algorithm becoming slow. We have for the static graph we have some gadget and we didn't check, but probably we can modify to have bad cases also for the temporal graph case. And probably, I mean, we didn't verify because it's hard to compute, but probably, I mean, I will conjecture that these graphs contain this kind of structure, bad structure.